Okay, so maybe first of all, I would like to thank to Diego and Jan for organizing the event. It was a lot of fun, and it's the first time I can have a beer while I'm making a booth, so it's a definite improvement over the Prague version. And I was forbidden to have a beer on the lunch menu. So I would like to first show a couple of data, you know, about where we are standing and how the LTO works at the moment. And then we can discuss what else is left to do. So this is kind of update of the last year BOF, that I was overviewing this last 5 years of LTO development. So I'm not going to do it this time. I have only slides what happened since last year. So we didn't solve all the problems, but we solved some. And one thing is that we have the simple table now. We have the partitioning, which is driven by the simple table, and it's kind of robust enough, so it doesn't produce the wrong code all the time as it used to. And we also fixed the simple renaming, so that was one of the major things, that LTO rename every single symbol in your program to something else, and it made the debugging impossible. So that's solved. The other important change is by Richard. You know, he rewrote the type merging, which was previously done in very ad hoc way. No, it's basically the type, it's basically tree merging. If we load two trees which are equivalent, like constructors or declarations, we just merge them. And it saves a lot of memory, and it's much faster than what we had before, and hopefully it doesn't cost so many bugs. We have slightly better inliner heuristics, and something I have implemented last week or a couple of weeks ago is the virtualization based on the one definition rule. So we can actually realize that two types are same in different C++ compilation units, and they virtualize based on them, which is something we didn't do. And there are a lot of bug fixes. So what works so far? We can bootstrap. What we don't do is that we don't default to the nofat LTO objects, which I think we should do, because users don't expect to compile everything twice. And it's simply stupid. And we should somehow gather some benefits out of it. So we should avoid exporting everything for plugins. We should have a plugin API. And we should avoid rebuilding every binary twice, because at the moment, we simply link everything twice to compute the checksum, which is silly. We have spec 2000 as 2006 working, up to some ICs at the moment, but it generally works. What I started to work in 2010 was to get a Firefox building, so the Firefox works. It still needs some patches to mark the symbol used, because they have some symbols which are called by ASM statements, and we optimize them away. And I have the summer of code student Martin Liška, who actually got working Chromium. So until last week, it was extremely fast, because it was displaying only empty pages. And now it's actually quite slower, because it displays the proper pages. We got the LibreOffice working, up to some unit tests. And Andy Green got Linux kernel working. So we can actually build quite a big applications and get a working binary. And I think the only major challenge is the glibc, which is going to be even more ugly than what we encountered so far. So I would like to show some data, which, as you see, I'm very convenient with this formatting tools, so I will just switch to this one. No, okay, let's see it this way. So that's what Martin sent me. He was working overnight. And this is how the Linux kernel works. So the Linux kernel is actually linking itself four times. So the compilation is about four times slower, which is expected. So if it linked itself one time, it would be about the same speed as the non-LTO build. And yeah, the parallelism is slightly smaller, because the kernel make files are pretty well optimized. And while we can optimize our build, we don't get it. And there are not really big size difference, which is mostly because of the modules in kernel. Now, the module interface basically is the same as our plugin interface. They export everything, so you cannot optimize through very well. Anyway, he sent me some some of the data about how the CPU looks. So these are the four links of the kernel. This is the serial stage of VPA, and this is the parallel Altran stage. So actually the parallelization seems to work relatively well. You know, if you see the volume of the graph, we actually can use more than one CPU for some real speed up. And this is the memory usage. So the memory usage goes up to 1 gig in the Altrans, in the VPA, you know, in the parallel stage. And then we need something like 2 gigs for Altrans, but it's because we use big parallelism. So if we didn't, then it's, I don't know, 16 CPUs. If we didn't have such a big parallelism, we wouldn't have such a big memory usage. So I think you can build, you know, LTO kernel on the notebook, and it works pretty well. It's over a couple of seconds. It's not minutes anymore. So yeah, this is the smaller kernel setup. So you can see that bigger kernel setup. Yeah, it's a bigger kernel setup. So it still gets to 5 gigs if you enable OES, but you don't do it anyway. And I will skip this, and well, maybe I will show Firefox. This is the Firefox I started with in 2010. So in 2010, it needed over 8 gigs of memory. Now it needs only 4 gigs of memory, and in compiles about 3 times as fast as it did back then. So we actually improved. You know, the Firefox has managed to get much bigger. So the today Firefox is about 4 times the size of the 2010 Firefox. And we need 16 gigs of memory, which is again too much. And you can see that the VPA stage is getting proportionally bigger because it doesn't scale that well with the C++ style programming. So that's something we need to solve. We need to make the types much smaller and get the streaming faster.
Wait for Android to be done.
Exactly. So, but it's actually, there are some actual benchmarks. So, I guess the short story is that if you have O3, you get about 4% of the speed up on the spec 2006. If you get the O3 and LTO, you get 8%, so it's a double of it. And then if you get PGO, you get also 8%, so it's about the same speed up as you get for LTO, which I think is surprisingly good, actually. And if you combine them together, you get pretty much the combined speed up, which I don't think is terrible. I don't know, you know, how big numbers I should expect here.
How did you get the LiPo number?
They are positive. The LiPo numbers, I think, are rubbish. Because I think couple of tests has failed, so you know, he sent me them today morning, so I didn't have chance to.
It's in 4.8. Mm-hmm. It's not in 4.9.
He got it from the Google branch.
That's it, the 4.8 branch.
Okay. The LiPo numbers are there because he put them there, you know, because I asked him to look what LiPo does, but it's not something which you should trust. So that's the size difference. You know, the O3 costs you about 20% of the code size, and the LTO with O2 saves you about 20% of size. You know, together you get about 1% size increase, and with PGO you get 7% smaller binary than O2 binary, which is still 12% faster. So, yeah. Again, I have no idea how other compilers are scaling in this, but at least the numbers are not negative. And what else do we have here? Yeah, there are the individual benchmarks. It's not that amazingly interesting. You know, it's like, you know, huge speedups or specific benchmarks, like Salang is very sensitive to LTO and PGO because it's kind of more complex than most of the other benchmarks. And somewhere here was also kernel numbers, which I might try to find. No, I don't have them. But anyway, there is this AIM-9 benchmark, which is speeding faster by about 14%. And the Apache benchmark is about 4%, if I remember well. So there are some speedups, they are not so great because the kernel actually is very well optimized. And what LTO is usually doing can be done by hand, and kernel has enough of effort to do it by hand. So there are some very rough numbers for Firefox. So I forgot to write the size, you know, I was typing it during the previous buff, and the buff was too interesting. So the non-LTO build is actually slightly smaller than the LTO build. It's over 50 megs, but it's not 51 megs, and it's starting slightly faster. But as I was trying to show on my previous talk, you know, if you limit the unit growth to 5%, then pretty much all the big applications get much smaller, and they don't lose any speed. So you get 46 megabytes of the binary and faster startup time. So it's something we should do. I don't know if we really want to divide programs between the small, medium size, and really big. It is what, for example, Open64 is doing, so it makes sense. But if someone knows about the better heuristics for inliner, I would be very happy to discuss it. This is the data from telemetry, which is the Firefox system, how to measure, you know, the individual task at the startup. So you can see that while the O2 with LTO is slightly slower at the end, you know, the unit growth 5 LTO is actually quite noticeably faster. It's now these 4 seconds instead of 5 seconds. And I tried to look, you know, this is my masterpiece of the graph generation. I tried to look, you know, which parts actually faster and slower. So what you see on the left are the relative speed ups over the O2 build. Slowdowns. So, you know, the negative numbers are better than the positive numbers, and it reads from the bottom. I don't know how to flip it to read from the top. And this small graph is actually showing the absolute time spent in every stage. So you see that the start, which is the loading of the binary, takes quite some time, and it's slower on the bigger build, you know, faster on the smaller build, which is what you would expect. And then somehow they spent a lot of time in some crash detection, which is about the same time. And there is this XPI Bootstrap add-ons, which is the only one which really regress. And I think that's loading of the other plugins. Because the XPI is this kind of library which links things together. And then, you know, this huge regression on the top is actually very small time here, so I think it's a measuring error. So in general, I think we have only one regression in one stage of the Firefox start, which is not as bad as I would expect. And this is the graph of the disk seeking of the Firefox. And as you can see, you know, this is the linking stage, which is the same. And this is the actual startup stage, which is kind of a random graph. So I think the story is that the code placement completely sucks. And the code placement is currently done in the way that I just do reverse top order, no, reverse post order, and I output the functions in that order. So we really need to work on some code layout for LTO. Mm-hmm.
So
that Firefox compiles with O3? Yeah, Firefox builds with O3 by default. I don't know, that's how he made it. But, you know, Firefox build builds with O3 and PGO, and yeah, the numbers are slightly different, but there is no intention, it is just, you know, how Martin made it. So that was the quick overview of the current status. And this is the things which I think are the most important to work on at the moment. So I think the main most important thing is that we are not really trying to preserve or merge the parameters from different units. And that's really hitting many users, because the users are not used to put the proper optimization parameters on the link time. And at the same time, we have some parameter preservation code, which works well enough to make user to not notice he's doing something stupid, but it doesn't work well enough to get him what he wants. So usually users build without optimization, and they are unhappy that LTO is much slower than before. And also on the Firefox, the very first unit is compiled for SSC 3 or 4. And what we do is to enable SSE3 for the whole Firefox build. So the binary crash on my machine, for example, because I don't have it. So that's definitely something we need to work on. Yeah, there are kind of the some of the other stuff, you know, for the kernel initialization. We need some kind of attribute that the function should be kept in some specific order, because that's how the kernel startup works. We definitely need to do something about the VPA, about the number of trees we load into the VPA stage, and how much time we spend working on those, which is combination of getting the types better, which is being worked on, and getting the debug info output early, which is the other buff, I go hope. And yeah, there are some other things, like I think we might try to actually switch to LTO for release builds, just for the sake of actually using it, because otherwise it will never get stable enough. So some regular LTO testing. And we might try to get some benefits out of it, like not having all inlines in the headers, but actually expecting LTO to optimize for us. And that would require solving this double linking problem, and maybe solving some of the problems, because at the moment the link time sucks, and it's really long, because we built these 6 binaries, we built every binary twice. So we have something like 5 times longer build time. And I think we really should switch the default to the non-FAT LTO objects, which is for the compilation perspective, which means that we really should make this GCC-LM and GCC-ARM wrappers somehow more convenient. So that was something I wanted to ask the Binutils developers, if we actually can install the plugin on some default path, so all the system installed compilers will have a plugin, all the plugins will be automatically loaded and they will recognize the LTO files. I don't know if that's feasible, but
I'm sure they'll accept patches.
Yeah. So the other thing is that it's really easy to use the R on the LTO objects and get the wrong libraries. So probably Binutils should warn at least, because it should recognize it's a GCC LTO object and it doesn't know what to do about it. Yeah. So that's really high on my wish list. And another high thing on the plugin is that I would really like to see the standard error as the compilation goes. It's really too painful to wait for the end of the compilation to see it. I still don't know what to do about it. So yeah, I guess this is my wish list. So I have heard from Jeff that at least Red Hat is looking on the GCC. I don't know if Jeff is here. You know, Jeff was mentioning that Red Hat has started to look on the LTO and there are some performance problems, so if you have some complaints.
I'll be putting our guys in contact with you as necessary.
Okay. So are there any topics which I have missed? Because otherwise we can kind of iterate through the topics and...
So the one, David
Edelson
is in the other one.
No, Google Dave. I wanted to ask him about LiPo, because one of the things, so LiPo is essentially LTO plus feedback optimization.
Yeah, in the way, you know, the LiPo for me is basically, you know, LTO on the specific portion of the program, right?
Right. Which means, what's the difference between doing FTO today plus LTO versus LiPo?
I think the scalability, because you know LiPo is probably much faster to build your application, right?
So because the nice thing about LiPo is it realizes that to do effective LTO, you really don't need to look at the whole program.
Exactly. Yeah.
And in fact, you only need to look at a minuscule fraction of your application.
Well, for inlining, I don't know how much this is true for the other analysis, but as you know, we don't get much else from the other analysis.
So what they found, and that's why I wanted David or Ron here, is as they grew the working set of the what LiPo looked at, performance stayed the same. Right, so they said, well, you know, you look at 2% of the nodes in the call graph, and you get this performance. You increase that working set, and your performance doesn't vary.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's
so, and that's a very cool result, because it means LTO really is doing a lot of redundant work for no reason. So if you know, if with LTO you get 20% improvement, and then LTO plus FDO, you get say 24, but with LiPo you get 23.5. You're much quicker in your build times than you win.
For very big applications like Firefox, it definitely makes sense. Yeah.
Right. So I was wondering about combining the two, and have LiPo. I want to get LiPo to
implement it on the top of LTO infrastructure. Yeah. That's what I hoped. It's Google working on that.
That's why I wanted it here. So.
Yeah, you know, as I was speaking, it's funny, you know, one of the simple ways around is to simply do very stupid LiPo in the plugin. The plugin can low-code the profile, it can see if the file looks important, and it can drop the non-important files, which will go through the normal length stage, and the important files will go through the LTO pass. It might work well enough.
Significantly
faster. Yeah. So that's something which might be easy enough to implement. You know, it's basically gluing some simple parser of the profile data into the linker plugin.
Right. So you can do separate subsets together. Whereas with LTO, you can drop the parts that are not very cold. You still have to do creating one subset, correct? So that's what you were talking about, just looking at the profile and only LTOing the ones that are hot. But you still are doing
Yeah, the idea is that you build everything with the FAT object, so they can be linked normally or they can be done by LTO.
Right.
Then you identify the object files. You don't do functions, you know, like LiPo is doing, because you just identify the object files which are yours. The rest will go through the normal linking, and then we will do this wall program stuff which, as we do. So, you know, the VPA plus parallel stage.
I guess I was just distinguishing that from LiPo, which can do several clumps.
Right.
It's a little bit different.
Yeah.
I mean,
but you don't need to bytecode all of the files that are involved.
For LiPo.
Right.
Yeah.
You only look at the ones that you care about.
Right. And from several clumps. Like this clump of things has a lot of power bits between some LTOs essentially. So it's doing this clump separately.
It's a bunch of partitions.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, I guess it really depends how fast you will get in this VPA stage. You know, if you profile it today, it's something like 40% of streaming in, which takes a lot of memory. Then something like 10% of the IP optimizations and another 40% of streaming out. So, you know, depending on the representation of the types we have, you know, this might get significantly faster. So the VPA might scale, you know, well enough even for programs which are 5 times the size of Firefox, you know, the identified part of the program. I don't know. Yeah, it's something which really depends on.
What machine did you use for measuring? Was it AMD or Intel?
The benchmarks. It's on the Martin's machine, which is Intel machine. Yeah.
Because I got a feeling that LTO gives like 3% improvement. I tried this on Spec 2000 on Intel machine. So
seems to be better, yeah.
For some reason, I don't know why.
I don't know. So yeah, we know we are tracking LTO and FDO on the periodic testers, and on the Spec 2000 the numbers are smaller. And I can show you the individual numbers. The speed ups seems to really come from kind of smaller set of the benchmarks, you know, which are
I see.
Yeah, so
actually
Especially in the...
I use Spec 2000. Mm-hmm. That's the difference.
Yeah.
You use Spec 2006.
So, you know, like, you know, here obviously the Xalang is the main difference, and then, you know, you have a couple of benchmark with this high percentage of speed up. So, it's actually the first time I have seen the LTO and PGO spec numbers today, so. But they don't look completely fake to me. So, So one of the important things, if there are no, I really wanted to discuss is this, how to solve the parameters. Because basically with Richard, we discussed it a couple of times, and Richard's opinion is that we should remember the command line parameters used at the compile time, and then we should simply partition the program based on the parameters used. So, you know, each set of parameters will go to different partition. And I don't like this way because basically it's kind of, you know, at the moment the partitioning is driven by the positive type of conditions. It's saying, you know, if this function is in this partition, then this function has to go to this partition too. And this is adding a negative condition into partitioning, which will definitely lead to the unsolvable partitioning problems.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's what I'm trying to get to. So the other...
The only time you really need to split them is when the options are incompatible.
Exactly, which...
bytecodes are incompatible.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
So you know, if one uses unsigned char and the other uses signed char, mm-hmm. then that would be a problem.
So... you know, what I'm thinking about approximately is that at the moment we have this kind of formal description of the options of GCC, but we don't know how the options are used. And I would annotate it with, you know, I would annotate the options with those which are actually affecting the late compilation, because, you know, a lot of options are resolved on the early compilation stages and they make no difference. And I would insist on the IP passes to actually handle the options correctly. So if you take, you know, F no inline module into the F inline compilation, it should just work. Yeah, then we need some kind of compatibility decision about the late options, like, you know, if you can inline fast mass into non-fast mass, and what will happen then. At least that's my vision in it, so.
Yeah, or try to represent the semantics of the flag So
of course, yeah, in the long term, yeah. But we need some solution, not in 10 years of time, you know, we need something which works.
And options in the function information.
Yeah, yeah, well, we have this option attribute which is basically doing it, but it doesn't work very well, and I see why people don't like it. You know, I don't like the implementation either, but I would go with it, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was just wondering, I worked on the Open64 IPA, and libraries were really problematic. Is a real link happening in this case as opposed to Open64, where it actually was treating objects as basically one long command line and then expecting some transitive closure operation to weed out unused code, which was really a disaster.
Well, I don't know exactly how the Open64 implementation works like, but you know, the way we do it is that we have this linker plugin, which Open64 doesn't have. It has some kind of small linker wrapper, right? And the linker actually tells us, you know, what symbols are used by the library. So it tells us, you know, this symbol is only yours, and this symbol is not yours. It's used externally,
so it's
and this is extremely useful for
that's much different.
That just solved the problem.
It's just going through the individual members.
Mm-hmm. But of course, we have the portability problem on this. Like, you know, we have support for Max, which doesn't work at the moment with plugin because their plugins are different from ours.
Yeah. Okay. Mm-hmm.
So, you know, the other thing is that we want to make the libraries which can be shipped in the bytecode format, which needs the standardized GIMPL, which is another action item, right? So that's going to be solved. I didn't even put it here. So we need, we need stable bytecode representation. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I guess yeah. So the agreement seems to be that we want to make this option attributes eventually working, and we need to eventually reduce the set of the options which are actually affecting the late compilation. So yeah, maybe I will try to start shifting things in this direction. Mm-hmm. So, the second thing on my list, which is maybe a little, is this no reorder attribute. It is for kernel, they are simply collecting the constructors into their own section, and they don't need, they need them to be kept in the original order. So, what they do is to compile everything with a no top level reorder. I don't know if it's a feasible idea, so, but maybe we can add an attribute for them if there is no really offending opinions about that.
I'm trying to reconcile the default to no fat LTO objects with the results that Diego just mentioned. Mm-hmm. That it might be useful to. It seems to me that it would be useful to have a way to reuse some of the code that was compiled in the first stage of mm-hmm. the first round of compilation. And only focus on LTO optimizations.
Yeah, but
in a subset of
that's a good point. You know, why I think the no fat LTO should be default is that first, you know, we have the people who are playing with LTO, like let's say Phoronix, and they just measure how long the compilation time it is, and they say, oh no, it's twice less slow. You know, it's a really crappy slow compilation model. So. We don't want to see that, you know, we want to have the LTO compilation time similar to the non-LTO compilation times. And the other thing is that the non-fat LTO actually makes you notice that we are not using LTO, you know. Very common mistake is to make the fat LTO objects, put them into the library without the proper wrapper, and then you lose the LTO data. And you get non-LTO build, which you think is LTO, and you are disappointed because it's not faster. So. You know, these two things makes the fat LTO objects kind of slippery. And I think that, you know, this smaller percentage of users like Google or Firefox, which really care about this kind of tricks, they will just enable it by hand. That's how I expect this to work. And also currently, this fat LTO objects, I kind of, they lead to the wrong code because you have the symbol table, which is a symbol table of your object, and you have the symbol table, which is a symbol table of your LTO data. They are not the same, you know, like in the object something might be optimized out, which is not optimized out in the LTO data. So you cannot expect this LTO, of, you know, the fat LTO work completely transparently. It's kind of a difficult feature to handle, at least with the current toolchain. So, mm-hmm. I don't know how much time we have.
10 more minutes.
10 more minutes?
But if you're done.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, let's see. So what is the interaction between feedback optimization and LTO and with respect to inline?
Oh, yeah, we do. Well, the way it works is that we make the basic, you know, edge profile on the compile time. We annotate it into the call graph and we store it. Then at the link time, you know, we read the profile and we use it for inlining decisions.
Oh, okay.
So that works pretty smoothly. What we don't do and we should do is, you know, we are able to resolve the indirect calls by profile feedback, but we can do it only inside the single compilation unit. We cannot do it over LTO, which is one of the LiPo features we are really missing. So that's something I want to add. The other thing I would like to add is that you don't really need to recompile again for the instrumentation. You know, it should be a link time option, not compile time option. But that's not how it works at the moment. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Guess is anyone else using LTO for static analysis?
Mm-hmm.
You posted it a while back. I've used my Python plugin to mm-hmm. basically hook into LTO mm-hmm. and then do cross translation unit mm-hmm. following data flow
mm-hmm.
and finding problems that way. I mean, is that something that is officially supported or that kind of LTO workflow? It's not really LTO, it's LTO.
Mm-hmm. Well, most of the stuff we do at the LTO level is actually analysis, you know, except for inlining in the way. But yeah, I don't know, you know, I have no really much of opinion about the GCC plugins. You know, I think it's something we want to support, but you know, the current plugin interface is kind of slippery, so it needs to be cleaned up. Yeah, if it works, then yeah. I'm definitely not trying to make it intentionally harder. So yeah, I would like to know what you use, and yeah, it's definitely something we want to do. You know, we want to do more of the static analysis in GCC itself. So. So I guess that's the it's the plan for next 5 years, I guess. And as at least the item number one will take it at least 5 years. So it would be really nice to think when you are writing a new code in GCC to actually store the things at the compile time, not make things dependent on the global flux in the late compilation. So I'm slowly shifting quick things that way, you know, like inline arrays already, you know, if you compile with O0. Now all the functions get no inline flag, and they are not inlined by the API inliner later. So that's actually the other problematic item. We usually crash when we try to combine together the O0 and O2 with LTO. Do we want to support the O0 LTO at all?
Sorry?
You know, do we want to support the LTO with O0? Is there any real benefit in that?
Now, you're so far from source that I don't know what kind of static analysis you can effectively do at that level. Because Gimbal is very far from the source.
Well, with O0 it's closer, but yeah.
Well, sometimes that's a bad idea, because sometimes you use an O0s when I want to debug things. So if it starts doing optimization and it jumps around in GDB, it might be.
Yeah, but you know, I think if you want to debug things, you don't want to use LTO. You know, if you
not yet.
Yeah.
But
you always have attributes which are, so it needs to be able to handle the functions which are compiled at level 0.
Yeah. You know, one thing I was really thinking about realistically is, you know, just to add the extra condition that the O0 and O2 doesn't mix, and you know, just make the link time fail, you know, saying sorry, you know, you cannot mix these two together. But I'm not sure now how if it will, you know, hit some real cases. Because actually sometimes it's even just a bug, you know, people mix together O0 and O2 because they don't know what they are doing. And I
Yeah, I was just wondering, in terms of percentage of gains of link time optimization, my gut feeling is that it's really just a important mechanism to be able to global inline. Is that your feeling too, or are there other things that you're getting out from it?
No, we got the global inlining. We got some benefits from constant propagation in the specific benchmarks. You know, it's what I was showing on the morning. But yeah, 99% is inlining. Yeah,
getting rid of functions that are not going to be called.
And removing the code, which is it's really like somewhere between 10 to 30% on the common applications of savings. And I think the code placement, because if you really get better on the code placement, that would be interesting. But I implemented a simple pass, which is gluing the things together where they are calling each other very often. And it doesn't seem to work well, you know. It, at least with the static analysis, it doesn't do much than the random ordering. Actually, it's worse than the random ordering, which is a little bit scary. So, yeah, it would be nice to have some experience in this area. The profile feedback works very well. I was showing it on the morning, I think, or maybe I skipped it. But, it's something like, it's one of the last tables. Now, if you look on the number of the pages read, then you get something like 40% savings on Inkscape or startup, and 20% on GIMP, and it translates into speed too. So I think, you know, if you systematically order binaries by the profile feedback, then the system should get visibly faster, because this initial startup costs are important.
There are aren't any more questions, we can go drink beer.
Uh-huh.
Okay, thanks,
Andy. Okay, thank you.